Welcome to Comic Power. I am your host, Comic Killer 72. Welcome to the segment called Top List. This is the segment where I give you the best of a particular category. Today, we're going to do the top 10 Asian comic book characters of all time. The month of May is Asian Heritage Month, so I was doing this to coincide with that. But I'm running a little behind, so it came a little later. But first of all, I have some rules, and here are five of them. Number one, the character must be depicted as being Asian on this initial creation, so therefore there will be no Psylocke. The character was originally created as a British white lady who was the sister of Captain Britain. And because comics are weird, she was reconfigured and redesigned into an Asian ninja warrior. That's way too much backstory to get into, so we'll come back to that another day. Number two, we're not talking about manga or anime characters. Some of the characters listed here may be influenced by those categories, but we're gonna stick to mainstream comics from North America that are superhero related. Number three, we're talking about superheroes and supervillains. We're not talking about supporting characters that have no powers. Number four, I do consider martial arts as a superpower. And number five, this is my personal list. If you don't like this list, please post your top 10 after looking at mine. Not only will I list the 10 best plus some honorable mentions, but I will also show their first appearance in comics. Diversity is a great thing, and if you don't believe that, you are watching the wrong channel. So without any further ado, let's get started on the top 10 Asian comic book characters of all time. Number 10. Shang-Chi, also known as the Master of Kung Fu. He's Chinese, and he is a hero. He made his debut in Marvel Special Edition number 15 in 1973. He's often compared to Bruce Lee, and for good reason. Bruce Lee is probably the best martial artist to ever live, and he passed tragically in July of 1973. Shang-Chi, the fictional character at Marvel, made his debut in December of 1973, so this may have been Marvel's way of paying homage to Bruce Lee by creating a fictional character similar to him. The Master of Kung Fu headlined his own title from 1974 to 1983 and was one of the few characters of color to headline his own title in comics. Marvel has updated the character and he made an appearance in Totally Awesome Hulk number 15 in early 2017 when Marvel assembled all of their Asian superheroes. The Master of Kung Fu would be a tremendous Netflix show to have, and 20 years ago Jet Li would have been a no-brainer to play the character, but he's too old now. I'm sure they can find a Chinese martial arts champion in his mid-20s to play the character. That would be so cool to see in live action. Number 9. Toyo Harada. He is a Japanese-American and he is a supervillain from Valiant Comics. He made his first appearance in comics in Solar, Man of the Atom number 3 in 1991. In Marvel Comics, people born with special powers are called mutants. In the Valiant universe, they're called Psyots. And he's the most powerful one known. And yes, he does want to take over the world, but he has a front as a businessman and a philanthropist. One of those offshoots is called the Harbinger Foundation, which is supposed to be helping kids, but secretly he's trying to find other Psyots like himself to build his own private army. So imagine if Professor X was an evil businessman. Some of his former students find out that he's evil and lead a rebellion against him. That's what's going on in Harbinger Renegades. Toyo Harada is not only just the bad guy for the Renegades, but he's the big bad for the whole Valiant universe. So think of him as Thanos. Harbinger will be the first movie that Valiant does in partnership with Sony. Ken Watanabe would be an obvious choice to play Toyo Harada. He's Japanese and in his late 50s, which fits the character. He had prominent roles in Batman Begins and Inception. The Toyo Harada character has powers on the level of Legion from X-Men, but not crazy, just evil. Telepathy, telekinesis, he's virtually almost unlimited. I would go ahead and get Solar Man to Adam number 3 and put it away. It's going to be a big book when this movie drops. Harbinger number 1, the first appearance of the Harbinger Renegades, is already up there in price already. Another must-have if you can afford it. If you buy it, make sure you get one with the coupon attached inside. Number 8. Maki Half-Wolf, and she is Chinese, and she made her first appearance in Monstrous number 1 in 2015 from Image Comics, so she's the newest character on this list. The world of Monstrous is written by a Chinese-American woman and drawn by a Japanese woman and influenced by anime, manga, and steampunk. Maki is from a race of beings called Arcanics, which are enslaved by humans in China in the early 20th century. She leads a revolt that lets her and some of her other Arcanics escape, and now she's on the run while trying to find out what happened to her long-lost mother. Maki also has a monster literally inside of her, so it uses the Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde archetype that the Incredible Hulk uses as well. The story arcs are usually slow building over 6 issues. think of the writer as sort of like a female Jonathan Hickman in terms of her style of writing. As you can see, the artwork is just gorgeous. I believe it would be way too expensive to make a movie about this project, so I believe it should be an animated show. And Maki should be voiced by YouTube star Anna Akana. She has a small cameo in the live-action Ant-Man movie. She has a YouTube channel that has 1.8 million subscribers, so she already has a following they could bring to the show. I swear Hollywood should hire me as a casting agent. Number 7. Cindy Moon, aka Silk, and she is a hero, and she is Korean American. She made her first appearance in Amazing Spider-Man Volume 3, Number 4. But let me clarify, she shows up as Cindy Moon in Amazing Spider-Man Number 1 and becomes Silk in Issue Number 4, which is the one which everyone wants. In a retold version of the Spider-Man story, not only was Peter Parker bit by a spider, young Cindy Moon also was bitten by a spider, which gave her abilities that were similar to Peter Parker. In the comic, she was hidden for years, held captive before she was freed by Spider-Man. Of course, they engaged in battle, but wound up kissing later, because that's what you do in comics. It's a big soap opera. They gave her own spinoff book in early 2015, which looked like this, and then they rebooted it and they made it look more manga looking in 2016 to the present. They got the character off to a good start and a great origin, but they don't seem to know what to do with her now. In the live-action Spider-Man Homecoming movie, there is an Asian actress that is cast for a character named Cindy. At the making of this video, Marvel has not confirmed if this is Cindy Moon or not. Most speculators believe it will be Cindy Moon, so there is action on Amazing Spider-Man number 4. With prices rising on it, maybe pretty soon we'll get a confirmation. Cindy Moon is a pretty cool character, but Marvel needs to figure out what they're going to do with her. Number 6. Rai, the protector of Japan. He's Japanese and he's a hero. Some people think it's Ray, but it's actually Rai. That's how it's pronounced by Jim Shooter, who created the character. His first appearance is in Magnus Robot Fire number 5 in 1991, which is actually a flip book. The front part has Magnus 5, the back part has Rai number 1. His first self-titled comic came out in March of 1992. In the 41st century, Japan has detached itself from the Earth and orbits around it in the shape of a dragon. And the Rai is a title that is passed down from one person to another. And the country is ran by artificial intelligence called the Father. In the miniseries 4001 AD from May of 2016, Rai and the Father have a disagreement, and Rai leads an uprising against Father. Valiant Comics is going to reboot Rai back to number 1 for a summer 2017 release. The word Rai is basically short for samurai. A Rai live action movie would be crazy expensive to try to make, so I don't think it's going to happen. But if it did, I had the perfect actor for it, and that's going to be Johnny Tree Nguyen. He's a stuntman and was involved in action scenes as Spider-Man, the Andrew Garfield version. He's a good looking guy, and he's got the physical attributes for this, so he should get a starring role in something like this. The Rai is a fantastic character, and the title is a superb science fiction action adventure. Number 5. Dr. Aphra from the Star Wars galaxy, and she's an Asian-looking lady of unknown origin. She made her first appearance in early 2015 in Darth Vader number 3, where Lord Vader recruits her for her weapon smuggling expertise. So she makes her start sort of like Han Solo, to where she doesn't really have a particular side in the war. She was so well received that they stopped publishing Darth Vader at issue 25 and gave her her own spin-off title in late 2016. They also crossed her over with Star Wars premier characters Luke Skywalker, Princess Leia, and Han Solo in the miniseries Star Wars Screaming Citadel, and then brought her into Star Wars proper with issue number 31. Like Han Solo before her, she was a space smuggler that shows that she can become a hero as well. The Asian market is huge when it comes to action movies, so to have an Asian character that has such a prominent role is even huger, if that's a word. Her timeline appears to fall after New Hope and before Empire. So if they do a movie that takes place during that time, I expect for her to show up in live action. But that's just speculation and what I think. And what I think is you should be getting Darth Vader number 3 if you haven't done so already. I also think that Olivia Munn would be perfect to play her if they cast this character in a live action movie. Olivia is actually pretty funny, and the Psylocke character didn't allow her to display her humor. But she did look good in the outfit. As Dr. Aphra, she will have elements to show some humor as well. Man, I would love to see that. If Olivia doesn't come back as Psylocke and X-Men, then Dr. Aphra all the way. Number 4. Kamala Khan, also known as the new Miss Marvel. She made her first appearance in Captain Marvel issue number 14. And this character is Marvel's future. She's Muslim. She's female. She's teenage. She's an inhuman. And she's Asian. She's the daughter of immigrants from Pakistan. She's also a 16-year-old nerd who writes her own fan fiction before she got her powers. The writer of Ms. Marvel is C. Willow Wilson, who's also a real-life Muslim. So the nuances of her religion are portrayed correctly. Being a Muslim is a part of who she is, but it isn't the sole driver of what she does. She's more closer to Ditko's Spider-Man than any other character. She's a teenager that just has been bestowed with superpowers, but also has to balance her family life as well. Due to the success of her solo series, they decided to make her an Avenger, and then she became a champion once the Young Avengers fell out with the main Avengers. Make no mistake about it, this character's popularity continues to grow, she's extremely relatable, and she's the future of Marvel Comics. I don't have any actresses I can think of that could play her in live action. Being Pakistani is so essential to her character, I think it would have to be someone who is Pakistani. And probably a newcomer to Hollywood, a fresh face. Number 3. Jubilee, which is short for Jubilation Lee. A fan favorite, she made her first appearance in Uncanny X-Men number 244. She was created as a replacement for Kitty Pryde to be the little sister type role, and most of her popularity comes from her big role that she played in the X-Men animated series in the early 1990s, where she's outed as a mutant by the Sentinels and they come chasing after her and she gets saved by Storm and Rogue. Those X-Men cartoons still hold up very well 25 years later. After years of fans screaming for it, they finally made her appear in a live-action movie. She was played by Lana Condor, who's a Vietnamese-American. This was almost perfect casting of what the character is supposed to look like. Unfortunately, this is Fox, so they messed it up. They did not give her a chance to show her powers in the final cut of the movie. And there was an ample opportunity to do so when the kids went to the mall. They could have recreated the scene that's so famous in the cartoon where she melts down the video game in the arcade. But this character has the iconic shades, always blowing the bubbles, and the big yellow jacket. Everyone recognizes this character. So hopefully they bring the character back and let the same actress play her, but actually give her something to do. This character is too well known and too loved to be such a throwaway character in the movie. In the comics, she's the leader of the rebranded Generation X. These characters are like the Breakfast Club, really. They're more weird than great. So I don't expect for this series to last, but it's a good chance to see Jubilee become a leader. Number 2. Shredder. He is Japanese and he is a villain and he is the arch enemy of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. People keep forgetting that TMNT actually started as a comic before it became this big huge empire. Not only is TMNT number 1 the first appearance of the Turtles, it's the first appearance of Shredder. When Eastland and Laird created this, they were just trying to do a spoof on Daredevil. They had no idea this thing was going to blow up this big. And every hero needs a great villain. And that's going to be Oroku Saki, also known as Shredder. He has a mastery of martial arts, including ninjutsu and hand-to-hand combat. And I love this character's design. It's easily recognizable. Everyone knows who this character is. And if you're going to cosplay this, you're going to put a lot of hours in to make it look right. Okay, before we get to number 1, let's list some honorable mentions of some characters that just barely missed a cut. Music, please. Katana from DC Comics. There's new interest in this character due to her live-action appearance in The Suicide Squad. Her first appearance is in The Brave and the Bold number 200 from 1983. Sunfire from Marvel Comics, a Japanese mutant who can generate super heat and fly. He first appeared in Uncanny X-Men number 64 in 1970. Lady Deathstrike from Marvel Comics, best known for her lethal adamantium fingertips. She first appeared in Alpha Flight number 33 in 1986. Kenan Kong from DC Comics, also known as New Superman. He first appeared in Batman Superman number 32. Morgan Murray, a superpowered teen on the run from the authorities, first appearing in We Can Never Go Home number 1 from Black Mass Studios. Mantis, there's new interest in this character due to her appearing in Guardians of the Galaxy Part 2 in live action. She first appeared in the comics in Avengers number 112 in 1973. Amadeus Cho, one of the smartest characters in the Marvel Universe. He's currently in the person of the Totally Awesome Hulk. His first appearance is in Amazing Fantasy Volume 2, number 15. The Silver Samurai, and he's a tenacious villain. Marvel hasn't been using him that much, not lately anyway. His first appearance is in Daredevil 111 back in 1974. The Ancient One with Marvel Comics, he first appears in Amazing Adventures number 1 in 1961. In the Doctor Strange continuity, he shows up in Strange Tales 110 in 1963. Dr. Mirage from Valiant Comics. She's a paranormal investigator that can speak with the dead. She first appears in Shadow Man Volume 4, Number 5 in 2013. The Shaolin Cowboy. I don't have enough time to explain just how crazy this is. His first appearance is in the Shaolin Cowboy Number 1 from 2004. He's currently being published on Dark Horse Comics. Okay, that's it for the honorable mentions. Let's get to numero uno. Number 1. The Mandarin, and he's the arch enemy of Iron Man, and he first appears in Tales of Suspense number 50 in 1964. And yes, we will discuss the 800-pound gorilla in the room about why Marvel didn't use the Mandarin in Iron Man 3, even though they did, but they didn't. Robert Downey Jr. is Tony Stark, aka Iron Man, rose a B-minus character up to an A-plus property. And Iron Man historically probably has one of the weakest rogues galleries out there. So if he has a clear arch enemy, you should be using him in the movie, don't you think? Well, it's not so simple, and it's because of cultural sensitivity. See, the Mandarin is an evil Chinese guy, and China is the biggest foreign market for American movies. And the Mandarin comes off to some as an evil Fu Manchu stereotype. Marvel has not portrayed any Asian characters of any prominence whatsoever in the movies yet, so if they introduced a character that so happened to be Asian that's also evil, there's no balance there, and the Chinese authorities could possibly block the movie from being shown in China, and you could lose $500 million. So I understand the cultural sensitivity and the money involved, but Marvel should have had the guts to do it anyway. By signing Ben Kingsley, you sort of had an out. This actor is of English and Indian descent. So they could have had him play the role of a character that's from a fictional Middle Eastern country. The 1960s Mandarin is a very goofy looking character, but when you update him like this, all of a sudden he looks very cool, just like how Valiant uses Toyo Harada. Hopefully Marvel will have the guts when they do Iron Man 4 to do the real Mandarin for real this time. No jokes and no playing around. And they can introduce a character like Amadeus Cho and make him a hero so you have balance of hero and villain. Alright, that concludes my list of the top 10 Asian comic book characters of all time. So, what do you think? Do you think there's anybody that's missing that should be on the list? What is your top 10? Please post it in the comment section below. As always, be sure to subscribe to this channel, share these videos on social media with other people so others can learn about the channel as well. Until we meet again, this is Comic Killer 72 for Comic Power saying bye-bye.